there is a saying in particular, comment that was made by a great philosopher, theologian, the Nicolaitan, Augustine, who said, God loves each of us as if there were only one of us. And I'm inspired because as I walked into the door, I saw the We Are One that has represented the theme of this gathering. So it isn't by God's grace, it is by His doing that we are gathered here together on this day. And I'm going to ask if you would take this moment as we together, united as one, would invoke the presence of God, and if you would be so kind, even to stand as we offer this invocation. O God of heaven, who is the King and Lord of both heaven and earth, we come together on this day first to give thanks to you for who you are and for your splendor and for your love and kindness towards us all. God, we thank you for how you have allowed us to set this day as a day of celebration and to reflect and to give honor and to esteem those in our community and those churches who have played so long a role in this area to partner and to be about our Father's business and to help to instill and to lead us to this day. Lord, we thank you for all that you have done. We thank you for the many who are represented. We thank you, God, for how your love has been birthed within us and how you have brought us, O God, even unto this place to give honor to those and to even not be so remiss in remembering that you are the very author and the finisher of our faith. Now together, O God, we lift you up. We magnify you for who you are. We give glory and honor to you. And we ask that you, O God, will be present in this midst and that you, O Lord, will let our hearts show forth love one to another as we go in furtherance of this service. Lord, we ask this in your name, and let all of the people gathered here together say, Amen. You may be seated.
Good afternoon. It is my sincere pleasure to welcome you to this amazing event. This is a celebration of Black History Month. This is a celebration of the accomplishments of those from African descent who in the face of controversy and adversity continue to rise. This is a celebration of diversity and inclusion and the recognition of all individuals for their uniqueness, their skills, and their abilities. This is a celebration of the 60 years the Norristown branch of the NAACP has served the community, even with challenging times and circumstances. The branch has continued to ensure the political, educational, social, and economic qualities of rights for the underserved. This is a celebration of Mount Zion AME Church, First Baptist Church of Norristown, Ebenezer Methodist Church, and Siloam Baptist Church, who have spiritually impacted the Norristown community for over 100 years and were involved in some way, shape, or fashion in the anti-slavery movement. This is a celebration of our connection as one people, one spirit, and one community. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Jaleela Parker, and I serve as the Executive Director of the Governor's Advisory Commission on African American Affairs, as well as the Deputy Director of the Southeast Regional Office. Thank you for allowing me to bring greetings on behalf of Governor Tom Wolf and First Lady Wolf, who couldn't be here personally today. Black History Month is the time of year where we as a nation revisit, reflect, and revere the accomplishments and achievements of African Americans. But it also should be the time of year where we stop and pause to understand the neglect and plight of some of our communities today. And that is where the NAACP and other organizations like it lead the charge on holding our leaders, Governor Wolf and others, accountable. But Governor Wolf gets it, he understands. And at this time, I would like to just read a note that he sent to the branch in honoring the churches as well. As a group, you have remained true to the principles and ideals of the NAACP's founders as you continue to help shape the nation's course. The dedication to progress, which has distinguished the NAACP for nearly a century, has never meant more to the future of our Commonwealth than it does today. We stand at a crossroads where we can either accept the status quo or take the necessary steps to progress. And the congregations honored at this luncheon show us the way as we seek to realize a future with political, educational, social, and economic equality for all. I applaud all gathered here today for their commitment to racial and social justice, and I'm sure that your example will serve as an inspiration for many years to come. On behalf of Governor Wolf and all the citizens of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, I commend each of you for your ongoing accomplishments and dedicated service. Please accept my best wishes for a memorial luncheon and continued success. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Val Arquist, Chair of the Montgomery County Board of Commissioners, and of course I'm here with Vice Chair, Mr. Ken Lawrence. We're honored to be here with you today to celebrate this wonderful event, to honor Black History Month, to celebrate 60 years of the Northtown NAACP, and to honor the four churches that have had over a century of service in Norristown: Ebenezer Methodist Church, First Baptist Church, Mount Zion AME Church, and Siloam Baptist Church. We have proclamations from the county signed by all three commissioners for each, both the NAACP and all four churches, which I will spare you the reading of. But let me just say that this importance of being one has never been more strongly felt than after some of the events of the last year. And one of the most wonderful things that we saw this late summer after the horrific events in Charlottesville was the coming together in Norristown for a rally of support for our community. And never more than that have I seen us be as one. And I hope that that is the spirit and the way that we can always go forward together. Thank you.
God is good.
All the time.
It's truly an honor to be here this afternoon. I do want to acknowledge one of our other county borough officers who is here as well, our treasurer, Jason Salas. He can be acknowledged. I want to congratulate all of the award winners, all the churches, all the award winners. But I also want to say thank you. I don't know where Mr. Milken is right now. Where's he sitting? Thank you. Since I've been a commissioner, he has led me and advised me. The leadership of the Norristown NAACP is truly needed and valued in Montgomery County. So I know you'll be up here at some point, right? But can we please just give President Milligan a hand? Thank you all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. A God of love, who precious and marvelous is your name. Truly your name is above every name, and we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor. We pray your blessings even now upon this food. Pray that you sanctify, purify, down, bless the hands of the prayer. Allow to bring nourishment to our bodies and strengthen to our soul. In Jesus' mighty name, we ask it all, and we consider it to be done. Amen.
Amen.
One thing I just want to say, I just want to reflect on what I made mention of earlier, and that the presence of the Lord is definitely in this place. As the Bible tells us, we're two or three gathered. And I can feel that in this room right now. So next up in our program, we're going to have a musical selection by Mr. Bruce Butler, On the Wings of Angels.
And I shall
Bruce, that was fantastic. Thank you so much. Give us another round of applause. We will now move into a spoken word from my neighbor.
Nation, we have come so far, but we can't stay here at the station. You see, every rail purpose or function and the Most High has a grand design. I believe we are seen. And I believe we have seen a lot of bad times in hypocrisy, but we cannot walk by faith simply alone. We must walk by, we cannot walk by sight simply alone. We must walk by faith and not by sight. For we miss out too many times because we are too well-built to know what the move of God looks like. So I challenge you today, let us work while it's day, because come the night, unless we forget, is more than just stained glass and steeples. It is about the fulfillment of a promise to a scattered people. So we can't stay here. I ask you again, what kind of history do you want to leave? You are seen in a stubborn garden. We have been tugging and born in and reborn again, but each new sunrise is a new chance at morning. Oh, sweet morning, cry out for the sun. The beauty of history, the beauty of history, the beauty of history, the beauty of his story, the beauty of history, the beauty of his story is that though it be distorted, it cannot be undone. Man of God, woman of God, shepherd and bride, I thank you. I thank you for teaching me that the battle is already won. So I call on those churches on the corner. I call on those pillars and I say, Ebenezer, you stone of help. Siloam, you spring sending forth First Baptist, you emerging us new. Mount Zion, you holy city on the hill of David. We call on you. We call on you. We call you by name and we say thank you. Thank you for your pioneering. There is more to come because Zion is nearing, so honor due to your history. It is a reverence for new eras that have begun, and there is a nearing of an expected end. A harvest and a clearing is coming, and faith coming by hearing is coming. They're saying there is a church on every corner. What good does that do? Well, there are corner boys and the walking dead, mothers and children, the lost and the living on those corners too. Some discerning and some aloof. But the truth is that we stand here today because of you. We stand here today on a shoulder's view, moving boulders because of you. As we get older, our past tends to change you. Everything becomes new. We are all on a pilgrimage just passing through. The Creator has called you by name, you holy pillars. That's the way the Creator recognizes you. So I call upon your name too, and I say, Ebenezer, the stone of help. Siloam, you spring, sending forth. First Baptist, emerging us new. Mount Zion, the holy place on the hill in the city of David. Thank you. We have come so far. And yet so much more there is still to do. The call still stands. I charge you now. Do what you have come here today to do. Take a look back at the past. Now take a look around. And in your mind's eye, I ask you, get the future in view. I charge you, in all of this celebrating, enjoy yourself. But don't stay here, because there is a chosen few still waiting on you. So whatever you do, when you put down your fork, when you put down your plate, pick back up your mantle, we thank you, and please continue. Thank you.
Prior to moving on, I just want to, again, give a round of applause to the young lady that there are in this room. That's a beautiful poem. It was moving, it was insightful, and most importantly, it provided us with a number of action items that we can take with us as we leave here today on our journey moving forward. Attention, please, to the volume of our videos today. I would just ask for everyone to politely lower their voices so that everyone is able to hear today's video.
I'm Radia.
We had the opportunity to interview four pastors from local churches
who were recognized by the NAACP.
We learned about their early lives, their churches, and their missions, and we learned a lot, and I hope you enjoy.
Can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you became a pastor?
I was born on the Eastern Shore, Maryland.
I grew up in West Virginia, which is why I mispronounce a lot of words.
I was born on a farm on the Eastern Shore of Maryland.
As a youth, I was involved in numerous activities in my church, particularly the youth group.
Drifted around until Uncle Sam said, "I need you," and I went in the Army.
I was head of the student Christian organization. The name of our group was Militants for Christ, and our motto was that there were militants for everything back in the 60s and 70s. Why not be a militant for Jesus Christ?
I did my undergrad at Washington and Lee University, which is in Virginia.
I experienced a call from God, and I answered. Took a while, but I answered.
Had an opportunity to preach at various churches, various denominations, which was very edifying and informational, because all churches are not the same.
And then I went to seminary, went to graduate school at Gordon Conwell Theological, which is outside of Boston.
Then began my pastoral career in Camden, New Jersey. I went there during the time Poppy Sharp was burning down Camden. It scared me. I thought I was in Vietnam.
I'm married to Amy Bounds. I have two children by the names of India and Zoe.
I had an opportunity to become a university chaplain at the same school which I attended, which is Lincoln University.
The first time that I arrived at Mount Zion through prayer and conversation, I knew that Mount Zion was a church that just was rooted and believed in outreach.
And later I came to Wilmington to our mother church, and again I was transferred to Norristown, Ebenezer.
And I'm also proud to say that I am a relative of Harriet Tubman.
And I've been here, like I said, for 8.5 years. I live in the borough. I just really love being able to be in Norristown.
What ministries do you have that focus on youth?
In terms of our youth, we have our Sunday school, and we have our children's church, which we call Kid Zone, which is a mixture of fun and games, as well as learning about what is in the Bible and how it would impact their lives.
One of our key ones is our youth group. They meet on the second and fourth Wednesdays at 7 p.m. and just have a bunch of students that come out there and they talk about what's going on in the world, what's going on in their worlds, and where does God connect with that.
Even those, the young people that may not be heading down the right way at this point, I believe if we go get them and share the love of Jesus with them and encourage them that they have purpose and destiny, I believe that can change the community too.
We also have a children's choir, which is the fascination of the church. They sing with such joy and such innocence that it brings joy to everyone who hears them.
One of the things that they're getting ready to do actually is head out on a mission trip this July. They're going to go to New Berlin, New York, and they're going to help in a community that's got a lot of poverty. And so they're going to be doing some work on home repair in houses for individuals who can't necessarily afford to do that on their own.
We also have a young adult class, which is for older teens.
One of the other things that we get to do for youth just in general and that we really enjoy doing and we get to do again this year is we put on a prom dress palooza, and we collect a bunch of dresses, generally more than 1,000, and on March 23rd and March 24th we'll be giving them away over at the high school.
The new media challenges that we have, or sometimes the older generation may be afraid to even interact with, but I find the young people can help our church grow.
And we also involve our young people in just about every other area of our church.
Young people, I feel, that have a great deal to offer, and we really need them, not just for the future, but for the present time.
Particularly to reach out to millennials. Mm-hmm. millennials are said to be anti-organizational, but we know they're not anti-God. So we have common ground.
What are your church's outreach initiatives?
Our outreaches are numerous. We call ourselves God's House of Hope, Healing, and Wholeness.
We have two forms of missionaries, home might missionaries, and then a foreign missionary in Europe. Our home might missionaries focus on disasters, problems, calls for help.
We have missionaries that go out any time of the night or day, especially when there's cold blue, where the coldest times of the year, where they would pass out blankets, sandwiches, and that kind of thing for those who are homeless.
We sponsor and support missionaries literally around the world. We probably give away somewhere on the order of $50,000 a year to various missions and missionaries.
We do a lot of work both in our community, in the U.S. and abroad.
What we try to do is focus, you know, our ministry that is connected to the one who we preach about, which is Jesus Christ.
Next month, for instance, we've got a team of people heading down to Houston, Texas. They're going to work where homes were devastated back in the fall by a hurricane that came through. And they'll be down there doing mud outs and just helping with families that didn't have flood insurance.
We are pleased to say that we have members of our church who are currently serving as missionaries in Peru. And we also support missionaries in Africa.
We partner with Convoy of Hope that we do every 2 years downtown in Norristown, yeah. Which is outreach where we just invite people to come to Eisenhower Middle School and give groceries and all the sort of fun stuff there.
They provide a coat and suit ministry. They provide feeding the homeless on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
We work with Habitat for Humanity and trying to partner with organizations that are right here in Norristown to be able to help our own community.
But perhaps the most important support we can give to missionaries is our prayers. And we are a church that believes fervently in prayer, the power of prayer, and the power of prayer to produce change.
We thrive on community cooperation.
What anniversary activities do you have planned?
We're actually in process of planning now for celebrating 190 years.
125 years this year.
177.
And so we are looking forward to that. We're already putting in order, you know, the banquet, the revivals, and church service that will, you know, have remembrance upon our founder, which is Bishop Richard Allen.
What are your church's most memorable historical accomplishments?
The most memorable are the ones that we're here to talk about today, and that was what we were able to be part of, along with several other churches in the Norristown area, in terms of the anti-slavery movement. Mm-hmm. And our involvement in that was probably twofold in ways that were most significant. One was that when we were still at that point down in downtown Norristown, so at what is now One Montgomery Plaza, we hosted abolitionists to be able to come and welcomed them into our church to hold meetings. And we had some famous folks like Frederick Douglass and Henry Box Brown were among that list of people who came and were speaking out against slavery.
For others, it was the addition that was added to the church after over 140 years.
That put our church at great risk, as it did, I think, for all the churches that were involved in that. We had windows broken and threats of vandalism. During that season, we had members of the congregation who were sleeping overnight because people in the community who were outraged that we were partnering with the abolitionist movement said, we're going to burn your building down.
They provided us places of protection for those who were actually moving toward the Underground Railroad.
1850, the U.S. government passed a law called the Fugitive Slave Law. And the law required that if you knew of an individual who had been able to escape from slavery and was living as a freed person, you were supposed to alert the police, and they were essentially going to be extradited back to their plantation. And the First Baptist Church composed a letter, and they said, it's not enough to just stand up in Norristown, we're going to stand up the U.S. government level. Mm-hmm. And they sent that letter to Congress. And the gist of the letter said, where the law of God that calls us to see dignity and worth in all people conflicts with the law of the land, we obey God.
Of course, the one that's probably most fresh in our minds is the marking of Ebenezer as a historic site.
They made those sorts of decisions to be able to say, no matter what the cost is to us, we're not going to participate in what we see as unjust and just wrong.
What are some unique facets about your church?
Maid's Day Off is a reference to a pattern or practice that existed about 125 years ago when the women who worked in various homes as maids would be given Thursday off. They would not be given off necessarily Saturday and Sunday as we traditionally do now, but because they were needed in the homes on the weekends, they would get Thursday off.
Music is an intercultural, interracial means of communication, enjoyment, but first of all, it is a means of praise, which is one of the first tasks of the church.
How do you feel that the NAACP is honoring your church at the Black History Celebration?
Well, I was a bit surprised at first when I heard and pleased.
Monumental honor, simply because my family had been great members of the NAACP on the Eastern Shore of Maryland. And so it's an honor.
And just really appreciative of the ways that the NAACP is looking within Norristown to say what churches have been part of that, and it's a privilege to be included on that list.
They were excited about the fact that a church that I'm pastor is being honored, especially since we were sort of, I would say, one of the pioneers for social action, speaking up for people that are unable to speak up for themselves.
We're inextricably bound together, the church and the NAACP. Being a Spencer church, of course, our church was a part, according to Bloxon, a part of the Underground Railroad was stationed there.
I think a big piece of what we've been talking about at FBC Norristown actually lines up with what the NAACP is honoring us for in our past. Part of my vision for our church is to see that become even more so part of our future.
I'm humbled that they thought enough of the church is. I know there's long been a connection between the NAACP and the churches, in particular the Black church, but not exclusively so.
It's a great honor that you know, we'll be an honor for something that we've been doing since the walkout of, you know, our founder of a church where he wasn't treated equally as well. So it's an honor.
The NAACP has had meetings in our church, and we're happy to host those meetings.
NAACP met in churches.
And I'm happy that we're moving together to begin to do work and projects together.
We were together during the 60s, the civil rights movement was led by churches and ministers, but arm in arm was the NAACP who fought.
What is your vision for your church this year?
Our theme lately has been one church. And the goal is that we not be a church of many ministries, but one church of many ministries that work together, strive together, praise together, succeeds together, even fails together.
A multifaceted approach to improve family life, individual life for minorities in Norristown.
The vision that was cast at Mount Zion at the moment of my arrival was to go get David, which is from the scripture, 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 11, where we believed that we wanted to go out and get those who were left behind or were overlooked and try to use the gifts that they had, which God gave them, to be a blessing to the church and to the community?
Our membership comes from the community mostly. We're not a commuting church. Mm-hmm. We are basically a neighborhood church.
So we've been talking January and now into February as a congregation around the theme of what does it look like to say we're a people called by God to live for God's kingdom on earth.
Mm-hmm. That includes prison ministry, educational efforts.
And there's the language we've used is to talk about the reality that there's a lot of things that won't be in heaven that are here today. Mm-hmm. Things like racism. Yeah. Like prejudice, like sexism, like poverty, like people who can't get health care. Those things are not going to be there one day. So what's it look like for us as a church now?
If there is one goal for this year, it is that we will grow closer together, that we will understand each other better.
To say we're going to fight the fight, whatever the cost may be, to work against those realities continuing to be systemic issues here in Norristown.
And that we will begin to work with even more harmony than we have in the past.
And that's going to take a lot more than our church. It's going to take an awful lot of people coming together to say, we're going to fight against this. But that's part of my vision for where I'm hoping God will continue to take FBC Norristown.
Together, we can do great things, and that's what I expect.
We will now move on to our awards. I would like to get first, Ms. Lillian, for the presentation of my apologies, I may hold this one to be noted. And I just want to reiterate and remind churches as well as the NAACP that accompanied with your awards will also be proclamations from the county. Those proclamations are signed off on by Chairwoman Dr. Valerie Arcus, Vice Chair Ken Lawrence, as well as County Commissioner Joe Daly.
Today, they asked me to introduce Ebenezer Church. Let me just tell you that there's a whole line and list of things that they've accomplished and their history in the program world. So I'm not going to go through all of that. But I will tell you that Ebenezer has been serving this community for 177, almost 78 years. As some of you have read, Ebenezer, a lot of their congregation came up through the Underground Railroad with the help of the Porson family, who were from Plymouth Meeting, Pennsylvania. You know, when Pastor Jarman's name is mentioned in the community, what goes along with that is that's the hardest working minister. He is there for everyone. Name, he comes running. And the thing about being a great church, you have to have a great shepherd to lead it. Yes. Pastor Jarman has been an exemplary shepherd at Ebenezer because he has a congregation that follows his lead. At any given time in the community, when things are going on and there are people in need, whether there's a fire or a loss of a loved one or kids in need, Pastor Jarman and his congregation are leading the way. So it gives me great pleasure this afternoon to present to the great and wonderful and magnificent Ebenezer Church our NAACP Awards.
Pastor Jarman, on behalf of the
white on a Saturday afternoon at a break around. I'm always tempted to try out my sermon for tomorrow. And as he means, we thank you for this award. And we thank you that you have thought so much of us in a community. A church cannot thrive without goodwill, yea, even love of thine other people. Bless you.
We will now have Mrs. Doris Smith-Starks, who will be presenting the award to the First Baptist Church of Norristown.
It is my honor and pleasure to give this reward to the First Baptist Church, and I've asked please that one of the representatives would please come. Three representatives?
We are blessed. We are continuing to be blessed. We ask God's blessing on every one of you here and those that you represent. And may we do the God's will and serve those who need to be served. Amen.
I will now call forward Brother Bernie Decker for the Mount Zion AME Church.
Pastor Bowers. document for this also, and one of our activity from the NAACP. It's just been a joy to be a part of this community. And I want to thank the Norristown area for receiving myself and my wife, Sister Amy. And it's just a joy to just continue to pray for us that God will still continue to use all of us that have been honored today to still have an impact on this community. May the Lord bless and keep you. Thank you so much.
We will now have the presentation for Siloam Baptist Church, done by Mr. Lewis Mason.
Praise the Lord.
Praise
the Lord. This is a great day in Norristown history and NAACP history. This is a great day. It gives me honor this afternoon to present this award to Siloam Baptist Church. Siloam, I've always been affiliated with since I was a child, and it is with the church of my sister. And I'm just excited to know what I know about Siloam Baptist Church. I'm excited about how it started, how on the May's Day Off Thursdays, how folk came from Wayne, other ministers, to meet, and it out of those meetings grew what we now know as Siloam. I think about all the rich pastors that have come through Siloam. When I think about Siloam, I think about it being having a strong presence in our community. I think about the rich sermons I hear all the time from across the street. Powerful sermons, powerful music. But I think about how it also meets the very diverse needs of our community. Siloam, and I think about it having always been there. While it's the youngest one of the churches that we're honored today, it still has served over 100 years. I think about also the dynamic pastor that they have in Reverend John H. West III. I know in the program, I see all the things that he has done. He came there in 1993, and he's still there. He's still standing. That's a long time for a ministry to still be standing, to be achieving, creating, to be building new buildings, to be adding on. There's life at Siloam, and we recognize that. But I wanted to say that I know him as my sister's pastor, but also I know him as a friend. This is a preaching brother with that deep bass voice. He's a brother that loves the Lord. No matter when he was young, he heard of the film that the organization was part of. But this brother loves the Lord, and he's about the business of the Lord. So I'm excited just today to be able to say that congratulations to Siloam. We honor and respect all that you've done for the community. And we'd like you to come at this time and receive this presentation. Join me, welcome. Eddie Thomas, the late Deacon Eddie Thomas, also the late Richard Downing, phenomenal deacons. Now look at these wonderful deacons here today.
To you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, and
one of the things that I find wonderful is that while we may worship at different churches, we worship the same God. We're going by His grace to the same heaven. And we work together for the common cause. I'm grateful today to have the privilege and honor to stand with these men to accept this award on behalf of the Siloam Baptist Church, God's house of hope, healing, and wholeness. And together, Norristown community, let's work together to make equality not something we strive for, but something we have achieved. God bless you.
Again, can we please give all of our churches a round of applause? We cannot thank each and every one of you enough for how much you do for our community. And again, I implore upon you, we must support these institutions because without the capital, they cannot do for the community as they would like to do. I would now like to call forward Ms. Jennifer Tompkins from the Norristown NAACP Youth Council. And Ms. Tompkins serves as the Youth Advisor. And as Ms. Tompkins comes forward, I would just like to say that this is very much a pivotal part of our program as we must continue to foster and cultivate the talents of our youth. Norristown has a great bunch of youth in this community, and we must continue to lead the charge and press forward and raise the bar and not lower it. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm going to say that again. Good afternoon. All right, if you can hear me, clap once. If you can hear me, clap twice. If you can hear me, clap three times. That's just a youth exercise that we do. So all of you in here are youthful. Give yourselves a round of applause. So I have the arduous task of keeping this to a few minutes, and I will. James Baldwin said that the most self-serving myth America tells is that all children are precious and are treated equally. We know in our history that that shows that is always not the case. But I am thankful that when America has fallen short of its promise, the children have spoken out. Let us remember, months before Rosa Parks sat down on that bus, it was a 15-year-old Claudette Colvin who was arrested for refusing to move her seat. Let us remember, in 1963, it wasn't until the little children of Birmingham flooded the streets in protest that segregation laws began to change. Let us remember, in 1964, it wasn't until college students traveled to the South for Freedom Summer that the needle for voting rights began to move and set the stage for the Civil Rights Act of 1965. And let us be prophetic in believing that on March 24th, 2018, thousands of children will go to Washington to protest gun laws and that they will change. So parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, pastors and evangelists and educators, if you know any 13 to 18-year-olds, do our society a favor and sign them up for the NAACP Youth Chapter. Membership applications are located in the back, and like our Facebook page, Norristown NAACP Youth Council. When W.E.B. Du Bois, a founding member of this great organization, the NAACP, became the first African-American to receive his PhD from Harvard University in 1895, and he was asked if he was honored to be allowed to receive his PhD from such a prestigious university. His response was this: The honor, I assure you, was all Harvard's. So again, parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, educators and pastors, the honor will be all ours to have your child in the NAACP youth chapter. Thank you. Before I skip off a little bit too early, we do have some of our youth council members here with us. I want to ask them to come to the front, and please let us give them a round of applause as they do come. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Let's again give our youth a round of applause. On the heels of having our youth just depart the stage, I also want to make mention that Dr. Samuel, Superintendent of Darcelle School District, has been kind enough to invite and sponsor the Office of the Attorney General for the State of Pennsylvania to come into Darcelle High School on Wednesday evening in the auditorium at 6 p.m. I would encourage all who have children that attend the Darcelle School District to come in for this very insightful and moving presentation where we will address issues of bullying prevention, internet safety and security, where things that we do on our tech devices fall under the Pennsylvania Crimes Code. This is an effort to be proactive as opposed to reactive, so we can stay in front and make sure that our youth are being properly educated and aware of what it is that they're doing on an everyday basis. So again, Wednesday evening, 6 p.m., Norristown High School. I encourage all who are able to attend. We will now have the President's Community Leadership Award, and the presenter will be Mr. John Miller.
So every year, the NAACP, we try to do our best to acknowledge an individual from our community who we feel had done an outstanding job in contributing to this year, we've selected Nelly Jimenez. Nelly is the executive director of the Trauma. So if you were to ask anyone in Norristown where any Latino who is in need, any need, can go for help, the first name that would come to mind is Aclamo. Aclamo Family Centers is a 501c3 organization which provides educational programs, social services, and health access to Latino and other low-income residents by empowering them to succeed and become productive members of society. Its vision is that every family, every child, and every adult will reach their full potential, independence, and happiness. Nellie is Aclamo's Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer. She has been the Executive Director for several years and has led the organization to the position of prominence that it stands today. I would not have time today to speak to the many accomplishments of Nellie and Aclamo. However, I will speak to the collaboration that she and her organization have helped provide in the NAACP. Many of you may remember that in September of last year, the NAACP organized a Stop the Hate rally on the steps of the Norristown Municipal Hall. We reached out to Nellie and asked her and Aclamo to join us. Nellie showed up as strength. And not only did she bring her supporters, but she also brought out the Spanish-speaking television. Thank you. In October of last year, our executive committee member, Renee Golden, coordinated a free dental clinic for all of Norristown residents, the volunteer services of Dr. Ned Savani. Renee reached out to Nellie to partner with the NAACP, and they worked together between them, and the result of that effort was we gave over 200 Norristown residents free dental exams. And and we would not have been able to accomplish that without the partnership with Nellie and the company. So at this point, the Greater North Carolina OACP would like to salute Nellie Jimenez and her great, for her courageous leadership and commitment to Bernard South Community.
Hey everybody, thank you so much for this honor. For 41 years, Sacramento Family Center has been serving the community in Montgomery County. And I just have the privilege to lead the organization, but in reality, our unsung heroes, our staff is the one who are doing the job. Actually, right now, my staff is still working. So on Monday through Saturday, we work very hard to make sure that a lot of our community members, many of them voiceless, many of them who are isolated, sad, sometimes disempowered, they find their voice through our job, our work, and our empowerment to make sure that they meet their basic needs and that they move forward. I want to thank you so much for this honor. Since I was very little, social justice has been my goal. I want to thank God, because without God, there is nothing in my life. And thank you. I want to thank my parents. They're both there. They're going to... This year, they're going to be 50 years in marriage, so I'm very proud of them. My parents instilling me love, instilling me service to others, and I try to make them proud. Sometimes, you know, I don't always listen. So in my imperfection, in my journey, I try to be part of something greater, and that's what I have found with you guys. When I came to Norristown, everybody has received me with their arms open. And again, when we talk about being one, you know that we are very imperfect. But within our imperfection, we're trying to find that place where we can all work together. And that's what I want to see, and that's what I wish for all of us in this room and for our community. Thank you so much again. Thank you for the staff, for all of the awesome heroes that are out there, for our teachers, the people who are providing services to those in the community that need them more. And thank you so much for everybody for supporting, you know, all of us in our community. So thank you.
So you guys probably couldn't tell Friday people who are very for me, but as a group, we're all really happy to do this. And, you know, many times you have a lot of people who you've partnered with, and you try to thank people, and when you try to thank people, you always tend to forget something. And so I want to try to take the opportunity to acknowledge some people that we had not acknowledged earlier. We've got a person that's partnered with us for many, many years. We've got Councilman Hakeem Jones sitting over here. There are other members of council besides the president who have been to our other events, and some of them weren't able to make it tonight, but they've been great supporters, and so I want to thank all of council for all the support that they've given us. We also have the school board. We have school board members Lewis Mason and Tiffany Henley. You know, I think that, you know, our school board has a lot of challenges, and the NAACP has been at school board meetings. We've work with the administrator, and I want to again thank Dr. Zenon, who's here. I know she was mentioned this earlier. We're making some very good efforts in the diversity initiatives in Norristown, and I think that the future is bright for our school board. So I want to thank all of you. We have Judge Patricia Cahoga. Am I pronouncing that correctly? Come on, stand up, please. Thank you for coming out to our fair. We also have a guy that's probably going to be the end before introducing him, but he has helped us so much. He is the immediate past president of the Norris Hill Men of Excellence. That's Ernest Trey Hebert. And then we have sitting just about in the middle of the room, my predecessor, the former president of the NAACP, Lana Shells. And, you know, my family turned out, so I gotta say hey to my family. Thank all of you for coming out. And my family, we've got people from Milligan and Company around the office. I want to thank them. Coming out, spending this Saturday. I also want to have a special thank you to all the clergy here. You know, when I was a young guy, this whole civil rights movement was led by the clergy. When I looked at TV and I saw the battles going on in the South, there were always the ministers leading the march. And, you know, the battle that we're fighting is a tough battle. And if we don't have God with us while we're in that battle, it's going to be so much tougher. So we are reaching out to the clergy. We're reaching out to all members of the churches in this community. And we're asking them to partner with you as we continue our fight for equal rights for people of color. So at this point, I want to ask Cynthia DeCourcy to come up, and while she's on her way up here, I just want to speak to the volunteers that we have in this organization. The people who work on this event worked endlessly. I'm going to ask Cynthia to come up, and I'm also going to ask her to just kind of invite some of the people who work on this event. It's just amazing to me how dedicated some of the people who work with us have been. And so I just want to say thank you to all of them, and I'm going to ask Cynthia to invite her crew up.
Thank you. Did you enjoy yourselves this afternoon? Ever worked on an event planning committee? Could you raise your hands? Then all of you know how challenging this type of a planning is to be as successful as we were today. And we just could not have done it without each one of you. But there's a special person that we'd like to recognize today. Before I call that individual up, I'd like all of the chairs, co-chairs that have worked on this month long. We've had a month long celebration of Black History Month in Norristown. The first ever for an NAACP. Please come, please.
come forward.